Nemo Radio is on the air.
A, B, C. A, always B, B, C, closing. Always be closing. Always be closing.
Shirley, you can't be serious.
I am serious. And don't call me Shirley.
Put that coffee down.
Coffee's for closers only.
Come after me! I'm a man! I'm 40!
All right, welcome back to another episode of Nemo Radio. This is going to be a really fun one. This is about a topic that I have so much passion behind. I'm such a big believer in this. And I found one of the top people in this space to really help educate you around the secret of leveraging books to really build your business. And so I'm going to bring on Raza Imam. He's an entrepreneur, an author, speaker, a coach. He's got a real passion for digital marketing and personal development. And Raza is somebody, as we'll get into his story, he has gone from kind of nowhere, off the radar, nobody knew who he was, to now he is a top Amazon business author. He's got this whole system going with different books he publishes and markets on Amazon Kindle. Done an incredible job. And so without further ado, I want to bring you in, my man. How have you been, Raza?
Oh, I'm doing great. Thank you so much, John. And really, you know, I feel kind of humbled and kind of embarrassed by that introduction.
Oh, wow.
It's really, really nice, man. I appreciate that a lot. And coming from you, it does mean a lot. So thank you so much for saying all that.
Everybody needs a good hype man, Raza. I'll be your hype. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the best-selling author of such hits as The Six-Figure Blogging Blueprint, LinkedIn Sales Machine, The Passive Income Playbook, and Build Ruthless Focus, Raza. Okay, I'll stop. But yeah, I mean, you've got like...
What was that movie? It was, it was like a movie from the 90s. I watched it as a kid. You're like, we're not worthy. We're not worthy.
Wayne's World. Yes.
Wayne's World.
I love it. So
I'm not worthy.
So let's first, before we break down all the secret sauce of how to get your books selling on Amazon like crazy and everything else, I want to start with kind of your story, because it's a unique journey, and it's something I think is important for people to know that you don't have to come at this. Raza didn't have a background as a famous author and, you know, blah, blah, blah. Like, you started, take us through this whole approach, because you've built a real empire here, but I want to know how it happened. So start at the beginning for us.
Yeah, totally. Thanks so much. So, you know, for the past probably like 10 years, I've been interested in, and I've been dabbling in online marketing. So I started, you know, probably 10 years ago, learning how to create a blog, how to get it ranked in Google, using search engine optimization. And it was a blog about something I was passionate about at the time, which was fitness. So I created a blog about fitness. And, you know, I remember the first sale I made on my site, I was selling someone else's ebook, and it was a $40 fitness ebook. And basically, I had a banner, like an image on my site describing the book. The users would come, or I guess my website readers would come. They would click that banner and then go to the sales page for that author. And, you know, he had like a pretty, you know, really good sales page and a whole sales funnel. And I remember getting my first sale. It was a $40 ebook, and I got a 60% commission. So it was like $25, $24.95. And I was just floored. I was like, I can't believe this. This is just amazing. I created a website in a few weeks, got it ranked on Google. And eventually it was at the point where it was making like 500 to like 1500 a month. And this is on top of my full-time job, right? So I'm an IT guy. I work for a hospital. But ever since then, I was really interested in the power and just really understanding online marketing. And not only just the tactics of, like, you know, how to get traffic and stuff, but really how to understand what it is that buyers want, the whole conversion process, understanding what drives and the psychology and the motivation that drives someone to actually search for something online, find an answer, and then eventually make a sale. So eventually what ended up happening is I had a few different websites, and there had been so many Google updates over the past few years, and they were really working on, making it so that people couldn't just create websites and rank them in Google and just sell products as an affiliate. And I understand why Google did that, because you had all sorts of websites, you know, clogging up the search engine results that were biased, that weren't very helpful, that didn't have a lot of authority or anything like that. So long story short, I had heard of Kindle publishing for a while, but since I was so busy doing the web stuff, I kind of put it on the back burner. But, you know, what really did it for me was when every other kind of avenue. So what I should say is I decided to write my own fitness book also. So I kind of got in shape and stuff like that. And I have three little kids and a full-time job, like I said, working for a hospital. And I took some time to get in shape. And then I documented that journey or that story. And I wrote it in the form of a book. And I was going to sell the book on my own website, kind of like that other guy that was selling the $40 ebook. I created an ebook. I was going to sell it for $40 and get Facebook ads traffic to sell the book. And that didn't work as expected. You know, paid advertising was something that it takes a lot of patience, a lot of skill, and, you know, the willingness to lose a lot of money on the front end while you test what really works. So long story short, that didn't work out. And then someone told me about publishing, or someone, re-mentioned to me that I should publish my book on Amazon. And the premise was so simple. They're like, look, Amazon has 300 million buyers with their credit cards preloaded, and they don't go there to watch videos. They don't go there to chat with friends. They don't go there to, you know, discuss politics. They go there to buy. And why aren't you publishing? Why don't you have your book on Amazon, where you have hundreds of millions of people whose number one reason for being there is to buy something? And I was like, man, that just makes so much sense. So I put that fitness book on Amazon, and within the first month, it became a bestseller. It made almost $2,000 just from the digital version alone. I didn't even think of creating a paperback or an audiobook version at the time. And that's when I said, wow, this thing can really go somewhere. So ever since then, that was back in 2016, you know, I've written other books. I stopped writing about fitness because that's not something that I really wanted to pursue as a real passion. And ever since then, like I said, I've kind of gone through the steps and figured out what works and what doesn't work with publishing books on Amazon, and it's been a lot of fun.
Yeah, and this has been, thank you for sharing your journey, because I think the key takeaway is, as I'm listening and for people listening to this episode, is, you know, Raza obviously has that IT background, that process oriented kind of find the problem, get a solution. But notice some of the key things he shared in his journey, which was, I really wanted to understand, how do people look for a solution online? What are they typing in? What are they looking for? What are these key things, the questions they're asking, the solutions they want? And then how do I kind of reverse engineer and document what I have available to, you know, solve that problem for them? And so what you've done is you've created kind of almost your own little virtual library of titles on here. And I'm on your Amazon page, and it's Six-Figure Blogging Blueprint, LinkedIn Sales Machine, Passive Income Playbook, The Science of Mental Toughness, like Build Ruthless Focus. Like, you've got all these books. I know you're doing, you know, a lot of revenue from this, but and what's the biggest hurdle do you think that people have in getting books onto Amazon? Because you're somebody that is cranking them out. And again, it's the thing I think people misunderstand, Raza, with Kindle books is they don't have to be like War and Peace in 100,000 words, right? Like, tell me a little bit about your process, how you get books on there, and why you think others are kind of holding back.
Oh, yeah, 100%. So two things else. You know, I have a few like mottos that I tell myself and I tell other people if they want to do this. It's like, number one, you know, model what works. You know, look at what's already working and model that or mimic it. And of course, don't copy it, don't steal, but just look at what's working. And the beauty of Amazon, this is the amazing thing about Amazon. You know, you have reviews. You can look at bestseller lists on Amazon. So let's say you write about a topic like nutrition, right? So you write about let's say you're a dietitian or a nutritionist and you want to write a book. All you have to do is go onto Amazon, go to the right category, and it's health, fitness, and dieting, and then like either cookbooks or diet and nutrition, and look at what's already selling. And you'll notice a few things. Number one, of course, you're going to have traditionally published authors. that have big budgets that are backed by big, you know, publishing houses. But you can still look at why they're selling, because the beauty is Amazon shows you reviews. And, you know, like I talked about earlier, going into the mind of the customer, and if you understand anything about copywriting and you know, sales and conversion and marketing, they always talk about, you know, you want to get into the mind of the customer and address the conversation in their head. Because if you can do that, they'll feel like you're actually connecting with them. They won't feel like you're just selling to them, because you don't want to just sell to somebody. You actually do genuinely, you know, if you're doing this for the right reasons, with sincerity and any, you know, care for your readers and your customers, you want to understand what problems they have, you know, what struggles they have, what challenges they have, and you want to give them the solution to that. So Amazon is so amazing and so powerful, because you can literally go and look at books, whether they're traditionally published or whether they're self-published, and see exactly what readers like. So you can read the reviews, and I always do that. I look at the positive reviews of you know, other books in categories that I want to compete in, or that I want to publish a book in. And I like to look at the negative reviews also. And what I found is a lot of times the negative reviews are, you know, people may say the book is a little bit too long. Just like you said, you know, it's like a 300-page book that could really be condensed down to like 100 or 150 pages. Like, this is too much fluff. Or they may say there's not enough actionable, practical, tactical advice. It's more theory. It's more, you know, hypothetical stuff, but it's not really practical and tactical. Or they may just say it's just not, you know, there's not enough step by step. So you can literally just look at the positive reviews, see what people like, and look at the negative reviews, see what people don't like, and use that to inform your own book. So that's like probably the number one advice I would give, is to look at what's already doing well on Amazon. Because if you, you know, obviously that's market validation right there. And if you can create something that's, you know, just as good or better, and I would even say this, it doesn't even need to be quote unquote better. It just needs to be different. And I think I might've even read that in one of your emails or in, you know, some of your content. It's with marketing, you need to be different. You don't necessarily need to be better, because better is really subjective. And it's hard to say, like, is a better book a longer book? Is a better book a book with more chapters? Is a better book a shorter book? So, you know, it's kind of hard to quantify that, but you do need to be different. So have a different angle, a different hook, a different, method to solve the problem. And, you know, again, give people what they want. And you do that by looking at the reviews, both the positive and the negative. So that's number one, do your research, you know, and Amazon makes it so simple. Number two, you know, I think one place where authors struggle is they don't do the research up front. And number two, they're not really thinking like marketers. You know, you have to think, I would even take that even one step further. Don't even think like a marketer, think like a startup company. You know, when you're publishing your book, you have to look at your book as your product. Let's say, you know, you imagine like your Facebook when they first started, or your Google when they first started, or your, you know, Uber when they first started. You really want to create a really cool, really unique, really compelling product, which is your book, of course, and get it and launch it aggressively. Get it in as many people's hands as possible. And if you do that, you know, I know of self-published authors who are making like $20,000 to $40,000 a month from their books on Amazon Kindle. Now, a lot of them use pen names, and they have ghostwriters writing their books, and they're really just writing to market and looking what's already popular, whether it's like Python programming or the ketogenic diet or whatever. And I kind of experimented with that a little bit as well, but I don't like that model as much, just chasing what's popular. You know, I like writing what I'm really passionate about, and I find that it works for me. But the point is that you really have to do your research, and then number two, you really have to think like a startup and think of your book as a product, or like a movie that you're gonna release, you know, and have like a really aggressive launch, get as much exposure as possible, and of course have a back end funnel, because your book, as you know, John, is just the tip of the iceberg. You can sell a book for 99 cents or $2.99, and sure, you'll earn royalties. I'll make anywhere from like $3,000 to $6,000 a month in royalties from the books, but the back end potential for coaching or selling online courses, or paid speaking is really, really big. You know, if you set your business up that way, if you set your book up that way.
Yeah, this is such good stuff. And you kind of pivoted into one of the topics I really wanted to help people understand, Raza, is why this is such a valuable marketing tool. Because a lot of people listening to this podcast, you're a coach, a consultant, a small business owner, a solopreneur. Like, you have all this great knowledge. You have all these great stories. You know, you're able to convey it to people conversationally, but you haven't ever taken the time to bottle it up as a book. You might have blogs, videos, podcasts, but like, if you even just kind of look back and say, what, how could I bottle up some of my favorite tips, formula, strategies as a simple book? And understanding there is no overhead. Like, there, this is not a physical product you have to hold in your garage like the 80s, you know, when you self-published. Yep. Like, it's all digital. And it, and even the print on demand, I had my 10-year-old in here the other day, Roz. I was ordering copies of my books for an event. And he's like, well, wait a minute. Like, how do you get the books made, Dad? And I'm like, they print them one at a time. It's called print on demand. There's no overhead. Amazon doesn't have a warehouse full of my books. Just as they get ordered, they print them and ship them. And it's 100% profit. So this is the power of this model. And then what Raza said that matters most is the back end. Books today are really business cards. They're, you know, authority builders, they're credibility builders. Imagine being able to walk in the room and say, hey, this is our speaker. He literally wrote the book on LinkedIn. You know, it's called LinkedIn Riches. You know, like, or he literally wrote the book on blogging. It's called Six-Figure Blogging Blueprint. And it's a bestseller on Amazon. Think of the instant credibility you get from having a book. I literally had someone in Lithuania reach out to me yesterday, wanted me to fly over there and speak on LinkedIn. Well, the only way they ever heard of me was my Kindle book for 99 cents, right? And I'm not going to do it because I don't want to fly that far. But it's like, sure. I have, from that 99 cent book, and I even give away my book for free on my website, LinkedInRiches.com. I've gotten 5-figure clients, right? You know, like tons and tons of revenue from a free to 99 cent book. And so that's another mistake people make with using books for marketing is not having, like you said, a back end funnel. The book is just the entree. It's the appetizer. It's, you know, the way to build people into your system. Because once they read a book, if you've done a good job, like Raza does and others do, is they get to know, like, and trust you. You share yourself in the journey. You don't just share simple tips and strategies. People get to sense your style and humor and stories. And now they go, well, what's next? Oh, he has an online course for $1,000. Oh, he has a coaching program. Talk a little bit about how you structure your funnel, because I think that'll be valuable for people who sell knowledge for a living, coaches, consultants, online courses. How do you kind of build that, Raza? What are some of the ways you do it?
Absolutely. So remind me to come back to that. You mentioned something that you, it's like my mind is racing, man. I love this. It's so cool. You mentioned your 10-year-old son.
Yeah.
So I'll talk about the funnel just a little bit. Just suffice it to say, I'm always testing and tweaking my funnel. And that's one thing to keep in mind. You always need to test it. Like, you know, sometimes you might think something's failing or something's not working right or something is, you know, is a dud, but that's not always the case. It just means you just need to keep testing and kind of tweaking and refining it and seeing what works. And that's just the mindset you have to have. So I'll definitely come back to that. But one thing you said that was so cool about the print on demand is, you know, I got 3 kids also. I have a 12-year-old, an 8-year-old, 12 and 8-year-old sons, and then a 3-year-old daughter. And I was telling my sons, I was like, you guys could write a book.
Right.
Literally, you guys could write a book. And they're like, Daddy, how much do you think we can make? I was like, you could probably make $100 a month. He's like, oh my God, are you kidding me? They're ecstatic. And the thing is, for anyone, like you said, who's a coach or consultant or solopreneur or entrepreneur or marketer or whatever, you don't need to write a big, thick, long book. Honestly, 75 to 125 pages is just fine because people want a quick solution, you know? And if you can give them the practical tips and strategies, like John mentioned, but wrap them into a story, people are going to feel like they know, like they've known you for years. You know, people are going to feel like, you know, I once heard this phrase, facts tell, but stories sell, right? I can give someone dry technical like how-to information, but if I can wrap that up into a story and say how I've done this or how I've seen someone else do this, then it's just amazing what they can, you know, it's amazing the connection that builds with the reader. So story is absolutely vital. So you don't need to write a long thick book, and really even a kid can do it. And I'm going to be coaching my sons this summer on how to write their first book But back to the issue of the funnel. Now, here's the thing. Just like you said, a 99-cent or a $2.99 book, you know, people will usually buy it just in a heartbeat. It's just an impulse buy. It's so inexpensive. And you need to make sure that in the beginning of the book, in the end of the book, maybe even a few times throughout the book, mention, you know, how they can contact you, whether you offer a free cheat sheet or something that I see that works really well also is to say, to give them a free copy of the audiobook. If they click a link and join your email list, to tell them you'll give them a free copy of the audiobook. That's kind of capitalizing on the massive popularity of podcasts and audiobooks. Or you can say, you know, thank you for buying the book. You know, click this link to watch a 10-minute video summary of the entire book, like the cliff notes of the book. So those are ways to get people onto your email list. Or you can be, you know, as simple as click here to schedule a call, you know, to discuss how, you know, your biggest challenge or whatever, something along those lines. Talking about funnel, talking about like a powerful funnel, check this guy out. There's a guy named Kevin Cruz, okay? Now, he was a VP for some Inc. 500 company in Philadelphia, and he quit his job, and he decided to write a book about something he knew about, which was employee engagement. So he wrote this book called, I think it's called Employee Engagement 2.0 or Employee Engagement or something like that. If you just look him up, his name is Kevin Cruz. Anyways, he wrote this book. He published it on Amazon. And in there, he said, for speaking opportunities, just contact this email or call this number. After he did that, he was getting 1 to 2 booked speaking engagements per month, and his minimum fee per engagement was $12,000. So he was making anywhere from $12,000 to like $25,000 a month from this little book. Now, he made probably like $1,000, $2,000 in royalties from the book sales, from the digital and paperback book sales, but he made like upwards of $20,000 a month from speaking. And he would speak to executives. He wasn't speaking at conferences. The funnel, his funnel was this. He had the book. Someone at a company, like a mid-size manufacturing company or somewhere, would buy the book. They would read it and they'd say, hey, we should have this guy come present at our next executive leadership meeting or our next executive retreat. So they would just contact him. He didn't have an elaborate email funnel with an autoresponder and all that stuff. The book just literally said, for speaking opportunities, email this number or email this address or call this number. And like I said, he didn't get 1 to 2 leads per month. He got 1 to 2 booked paid speaking gigs per month. And he was literally just doing a 1-hour talk to a team of executives at their retreat. And he would do this around the country. And he was able to do it. And he had 3 kids also. And he was able to just do this.
From I love his this.
Book. Such yeah. a simple funnel. He made like $245,000 that year after he quit his job. And now he's got some big leadership training consulting company and all that stuff. But it all started from his book. So really, sometimes people think like an online sales funnel, you know, has to be complex and they get intimidated and they're not tech savvy. I say dumb it down. Keep it simple. You know, just get people, you know, just have people contact you some way. Here's another story. I had, for my book, Build Ruthless Focus, this guy joined my email list. I think I offer like a free 1-page cheat sheet on how to get focused in like 60 seconds. So he downloaded that. He emailed me. He's like, you know, I really like this content. I've never heard anything like it. I'd love to work with you. And I kind of didn't respond to him as soon as I'd like to it, as I would have liked to. Because again, I still have a full-time job and I still have 3 little kids. So he emailed me again. He's like, I really like your content. And I really want to work with you. So I scheduled a call with him. And he ended up being a CEO of a software company in Hawaii, of all places.
Wow.
And he ended up paying me $2,000 to coach him on how to get more focused and productive and all that stuff. And
that's awesome.
I was like, amazing. Just absolutely amazing. So really, don't get hung up on the mechanics of how to build a sales funnel and whether you should use this tool or that tool or anything. But again, if you're addressing core human needs, if you are empathizing with their problems, if you're showing a solution to their problems and you're wrapping that all up into a story, people are going to feel so connected to you. And if you, and then, you know, at the end of all that, if you make it easy for them to contact you, if you give them your email or, you know, if you have a private Facebook group that they can join or something, just some way that they can get a hold of you, there's so much you can do. So, you know, sometimes on the online marketing world, we think funnels have to be really elaborate and complex. But again, we're dealing with human beings.
Right.
We're dealing with their needs and their fears and their aspirations and their desires. And if you can just come across as a human being that understands their human issues, that's really, really the heart of all of it.
And this is why books are so powerful, because, you know, they're my favorite form of what I call content marketing, because they do two things. They demonstrate your expertise. They demonstrate your value. You're teaching people while they're reading, but they also help people get to know, like, and trust you. Because if you're doing it, like Raza mentions, where you're sharing great stories and sharing, you know, experiences from your journey, they're going, wow, Raza's so relatable. He's got the three kids, he's got the day job, and man, this random person in Hawaii bought his book for a buck and paid him $2,000, like basically chased him. And that's the other great thing about books is they pre-qualify people. The sale process Raza had, if Raza had started cold with some random CEO who had never heard of him and said, hey, I want to charge you $2,000 to coach you for a little while on focus, that's a much more difficult, heavy lifting kind of sales conversation, as opposed to, I already pre-qualified myself. I devoured your content. How do I give you money? Like, that's literally the difference. And all my best clients, all my easiest sales, every seamless, you know, selling interaction has come because someone first read a book. It has, without fail, has been the case for me. And again, when I now meet cold prospects and, hey, can I hire you to do this or this or this? I'll say, how have you heard of me? Oh, I just found you on the internet. I'm like, why don't you read the book first? Here it is for free. Because I want to pre-qualify them. I want the book to handle all those objections and concerns. And instead of doing an hour-long call where they go, well, now I have to think about it and ask you a bunch of questions, just let your book do all the heavy lifting. It's been an incredible thing. And so now, obviously, we could talk all day about why books are so powerful. And I love what you said about you don't have to overcomplicate it. You don't have to get hung up on the tools and the tech. Just extend the conversation. Would you like to learn more? Would you like to talk to me personally? Would you like free training, you know, that's an extension of the book? Go online, get on this list. So let's pivot out of that. Now I'm convinced and I want to do books on Amazon. What's the secret sauce, Raza, to getting them to be bestsellers, to getting them ranked? Because I can't imagine there's got to be billions of books on there by now, because anyone, again, for free can self-publish. You can upload a PDF. You can make your own cover, throw it on there. It's a pretty low bar to get a book published. So how do you stand out from the crowd, maybe just at a high level even? How do you get your books ranked?
Great, great question. Awesome. And I'm going to give you the three secrets or the three biggest levers to really make it work. And like I like to do, I'm going to do it in story form, because I hope that'll resonate and sink in more. So number one, you have to have a great, great title and subtitle. Because again, we're selling these books to human beings, and we want to address their deepest needs, their pains, their desires, their emotions, right? So you have to spend so much time on an awesome title and subtitle. Usually I like to use alliteration in the title. So like passive income playbook, six-figure blogging blueprint. LinkedIn sales machine doesn't have alliteration, but you get the point. You want it to be something that kind of rolls off the tongue. And then the title has to have like a really descriptive benefit or address a certain problem, because again, that's really going to be what is going to connect with your readers. Now, I'm sure you know all about copywriting, you know, the world's best copywriters and ad writers, they spend 80% of their time on the headline of their ad, or the headline of their you know, commercial, the first 10 seconds of the commercial or whatever it is, because they have to hook the reader. They have to address the conversation in their mind. They have to address their emotions to get them interested. So really, you want to spend 80% of your time on the title and subtitle. And I would literally write out 20 different titles and subtitles. I just open up I send an email to myself, like a draft email, and I'll literally write them out, or I'll put them in a notepad document. And the first ones may not be that good, but just the process of writing out 20 different titles, well, it'll like trigger something in your subconscious where you start coming up with gems. Like, most of them are going to be just bad, but that's okay. Have fun with it. Just realize it's a game, and just say, okay, I'm going to take these steps. And I know my subconscious mind, and you know, we're kind of getting into the psycho-cybernetics a little bit here. It will kick in. I want to create an awesome, compelling title. Let me just do these steps. My mind will give me what I need. Okay, so that's number one. Awesome title and subtitle. You know, that really addresses a need, and that's really just like different. And you can look at other subtitles. Again, look at Amazon, see what other titles and subtitles there are, and see what's already working, what's already selling well. So that's number one.
And
number
two, before you go further though, before we get to number two, I gotta jump in because your titles do this so well. This is the last thing. He catches your attention with the topic. So like blogging, LinkedIn, passive income, mental toughness, right? Ruthless focus. Like Raza always has a topic in his title, so you know what the book is about because people are searching Amazon. It's one of the world's biggest search engines. I need a book on using LinkedIn. So LinkedIn is in his title. I want a book on blogging. But then the other big thing Raza does with his titles is a benefit, a promise, a six-figure blogging blueprint, right? Six figures. Yep. That's a benefit. That's a promise. And then his subtitles help you overcome objections, right? So six-figure blogging blueprint, how to start an amazingly profitable blog. And then here's the beautiful thing, the speed. People want fast and easy. In the next 60 days, and then also, I don't know how to do it, even if you have no experience. That's also in the sub headline. Or LinkedIn sales machine. I want to sell on LinkedIn. Okay, that's the headline. The secret strategy. Oh, there's something unique. Curious. To generate leads and sales on LinkedIn in 30 minutes a day. What? Like, I only have to spend half an hour. Like, think of these titles. They're irresistible, especially for a dollar. Why wouldn't I throw a dollar at that? Right? Like, seriously. Like, even if I get one idea out of this book, it's only a buck. Why wouldn't I take a shot, right? And so that's number one, is you've got to put, like Raza said, 90%, 80% of your effort into coming up with that title, the subject, the topic, plus a benefit, and then the subheadline that overcomes those common objections. I don't have the experience, or I don't have time, or whatever the common ones are. Study Raza's Amazon page, Raza Imam, R-A-Z-A-I-M-A-M, and look at his titles. They all do that. So kudos to you on step one. What's step two?
Thank you. That's so kind of you to say, man. Again, I'm flattered and humbled, so thank you so much. So step two. Step two is to have a really good cover. And since you know, I just write nonfiction, I don't write fiction, the covers should be simple. They should have stark color contrast. They should have big titles. And again, or big, you know, big letters for the main title. Again, look at the best selling books in your genre, in your category. Like, I'm trying to think what some of the books are that are selling really well right now. I'm kind of drawing a blank, but just go on Amazon, look at the nonfiction, or look at the business and investing, or look at the self-help bestsellers, and you'll see some of those common elements. They don't have a lot of like clip art or a lot of, you know, irrelevant images. Like, you know, I'll tell you, two people that are really good with their covers are Malcolm Gladwell. It's usually like a big title with like a subtle image, like a matchstick, or you know, I forgot what his other covers are. Or the guy Michael Lewis. I think he wrote Moneyball.
Moneyball, yep.
Yeah, like simple covers, you know, with an image that kind of doesn't overpower the title, but it's subtle enough that it blends into the title or it integrates well with the title. And I'll tell you, one of your students, Dr. Eric Frazier, you actually referred him to me. He has a great, great book title, cover and book called The Psychology of Top Talent. I think it's like how to attract, train, and develop top talent or something like that.
Stop here. This is another good story. So Eric Frazier came to me for coaching and LinkedIn help. I said, you want to, and he's like, I have a book. I want to market it on Amazon. I wrote it. I was like, stop right there. Right. Yeah. At the Meatloaf song. I'm like, go talk to Raza. So Raza gets them all set up. The Psychology of Top Talent. All it is a dart, a small red dart. And it's a blank white cover, like just dialed in, like the dart, you know, kind of, you think of the bullseye landing on the bullseye, but it says The Psychology of Top Talent, the practical scientifically proven method to identify, hire, and develop top performers. Now here's the backstory to Eric Frazier. He got all this launched, he got the book out there, 99 cents, whatever. He got booked on the Morning Joe, I believe it was, national TV show from that Kindle book. Some producer there was trolling Amazon looking for something about the job market and hiring people, got intrigued by Eric's book, bought it for a buck or whatever it was, and booked him from his book on national TV. I'm like, oh my gosh, like Raza's good, man. So
thanks. I'm so glad you told that story, because I was going to say that story. And you know, Eric gets like 100% of the credit. He worked hard, man. Like, I mean,
he
I
did.
I told him, I want you to write out 20 covers. I'm sorry, 20 titles. He wrote out 20 titles, literally. And I looked at them with him, and so this is the beauty. When you do that, you can look at your document and you can say, I like this title and I like this subtitle. So we took like a mishmash of what he had written. We took one of the titles he had wrote, which is, again, The Psychology of Top Talent. And then we took a subtitle he wrote that was attached to another title. You know, we mixed it together. We had the winning title. Then I said, okay, now you need to create covers. He went on, I think, like 99 Designs or one of these websites. He spent a few hundred bucks to get like dozens of covers. We looked at all of them. We narrowed it down to this one, which obviously was a winner. Just a beautiful cover. You know, it looks like a Michael Lewis or a Malcolm Gladwell type of cover. Right?
It does.
And then, like you said, he published it. He got a little bit of traction in the beginning, but this is the beauty of the funnel and the back end. You know, sometimes people's launch doesn't go as well as expected, but that's okay, because you don't need to make $5,000 a month in royalties like I do. If you have a back end business, like he's a psychologist, he's a forensic psychologist. He wants to use his expertise to help companies develop top talent. He doesn't need to make thousands on Amazon from his royalties.
Correct.
He needs to be doing like $10,000, $20,000 consulting gigs and speaking gigs for big corporations, right? So that's exactly what he was able to do. Just like you said, he got onto the Morning Joe show with Joe Scarborough. He did it was a great interview. You know, he was talking about millennials and identifying millennials, and how to you know, motivate them and all that stuff. And his book sold really well after that as well. So that's the importance of a great title and a great cover, because, and that leads into the step number three, which is the launch, right? So you have to launch the book aggressively. You really have to launch the book aggressively. And there's like, there's Kindle deal websites where you can do your promotion. There's Amazon advertising, but what people usually do is they just kind of leave it at that. They just do like a launch in the beginning. The book, they call it the bestseller hangover. So you'll become a bestseller. You know, your book is priced at 90, your Kindle book is priced at 99 cents. Your paperback is priced at like 15 bucks or whatever. You'll become a bestseller for a month, get really excited, and then it'll fizzle out. And then people kind of get down and they feel like, oh, this doesn't work. Why did I spend all this time in a book? My response to that is, that's just the beginning. Because again, if you structure your business properly and you have a back end set up, your book and your launch is just the beginning. Now what you start doing with that book is you reach out to industry associations. So, you know, he's a psychologist. He can reach out to HR organizations across the country. There's an organization called SHRM, I think, the Society of Human Resource Management Professionals or something. He can reach out to, he can reach out to like IT trade groups. If you want to consult with tech companies that are in this cutthroat business of hiring and retaining top programmers, he can reach out to those groups and say, hey, I wrote this book. I've spoken at Google and Cisco. I've been featured on the Morning Joe show. If you need, I'd love to give a speech to your, you know, at your next event or at your next conference or whatever. So, or another way to promote your book is to get on podcasts, make a list of relevant podcasts and reach out. So I'm a best-selling author. I've been featured here. This is my professional experience. I'd love to help you. I'd love to share some of my tips and insight with you. And
everyone wants to book an author, dude. Nobody wants to book a coach. No one wants to book a consultant. They want to book an author. They want to book an author because that gives you that extra layer of credibility for their audience, especially if you're a best-selling author. And that's not hard to do if you follow Raza's approach. By the way, before I forget, everyone just needs to hire Raza and give him all your money. Like, I will, full disclosure, I hired Raza to do my most recent book, Content Marketing Machine, and I hit number one on a bunch of lists. And I did it using the specific approaches he took. And what's been interesting is the other thing I did with the book and with my other book, LinkedIn Rich, is when I went to a live conference, a trade show, I went to Social Media Marketing World in March in San Diego. I did the print-on-demand deal. You can print author copies for like $2 a book. I printed, I think, 400 books total, so like 200 of each title, shipped them all to my hotel room in San Diego, paid the shipping, and handed them out like business cards. And there were, I think they had like 2,000 people at that conference. I walked out of there with well into the mid five figures of new clients, online courses, coaching, from probably a $500 investment in books. And the reason it worked so well, Raza, was when I was walking the floor, everyone else was handing out business cards. I was handing out books. And I had an icebreaker because people are like, what are you carrying that pile of stack of books around for? What are you reading? And then I'd say, oh, well, I'm giving out my book for free. Instead of just a business card, I thought I'd give you something to read on the plane or give you something of value. Are you interested in LinkedIn? Here's my LinkedIn book. You're interested in content? Here's the content book. And what happened was at this event, it went over 3 days and I was speaking there. I had a packed session. I had everyone in there because I was like, well, hey, I'm giving out my free book. I'm speaking at 4:00. And there were hundreds of sessions, hundreds of presenters. I filled mine up because it was like handing out a free copy of your CD before the concert, right? And I'm going back to the 80s when bands had CDs, but it was like handing out your record for free and going, hey, we're playing this Friday. Come check out the show. So it was like, you also have that ability and people get excited. And it was really funny, Raza, because I'm a total nobody. And people will be like, oh, will you sign it for me? Like, I'm fan. Like, you want me to sign your book? Okay. Like John Nemo. Like, but people, again, there's this status associated with being a published author where random strangers, oh, you're the author. Please sign this for me. Can I get a photo? Like, they didn't even know who I was. It didn't matter. It was like, you have a book. It has bestseller, like whatever. And don't underestimate the power of this. So
I love that story, man. John, that made me so happy.
Yeah, and it worked. Awesome. It happened. And I will say to Roz's point, then after I launched, the things tailed off. And so what I have found, I finally got going on Amazon ads and I found a good person for that. And my LinkedIn Riches book is consistently hitting number one on multiple lists. My content marketing book is not, it's struggling because it's just, I should have listened to Raza. I didn't do the title Raza suggested. I'm just going to call myself out. You were like, you called me out. You're like, I don't know about you. And I was like, I'm going to do it. And now I'm like, crap, I should change the title. But anyway, it's still selling really well. It's a confounding topic. That's the problem. But this is
what I'm talking about. You know, to your point, I'm so sorry to interrupt you, but you just brought up a really good point. Forgive me for interrupting you, but check this out. The beauty of self-publishing is you don't need to go to your publisher and ask them for permission to change your title. You can change it on the fly. You can pay someone on Fiverr $5 to change your title. Your book cover to reflect a new title or subtitle. Boom, done. It's agile. It's just in time. It's all this stuff, you know, like from the tech world, you know?
That's what I should say too with self-publishing. Like you can update and put new editions of your book out. You just update the document, the text, and upload it again or upload the new cover. You want an award? Upload a new cover with the award banner on it. Like this is the real-time nature of it. And again, this extending it through different platforms, Facebook ads, Amazon ads, the Kindle book sites, like you can keep your book at the top of these lists. And again, I was texting Raza the other day. I'm like, should I raise the price? Cause I'm losing money on the ads, you know, cause I'm selling it for $1. And you were like, no, dude, you're ranking so high. If you jack up the price in your Kindle book, is that worth losing the back end sale of a $2,000 online course? I'm like, oh yeah, idiot. No, like quit looking at the short term. Even I do that. You've got to play the long game with these books. And no, the more copies of your book get out there and dispersed into the world, the more comes on the back end. You know, my belief, my thing I have to remind myself of, and that Raza did, was play the long game. The idea is just to get the book out there to as many people as possible. Yes, it's nice to make a few thousand bucks a month on royalties, but the real money comes on the back end. Speaking gigs, online courses, coaching, consulting, products, whatever it is. And so let's bring this in for a landing because there's so much opportunity here. There are so many people that I know want to do this and need to do this, Raza. So how can they just hire you to do it? Sorry, you're amazing. But how can people find you online? I know, do you still do this? Or have you kind of turned that part of the business off where you do it for people?
Oh, great point. I'm still actively in the market doing it. I have 5 books that I have. I have 2 that are kind of like semi-written. I've just gotten done creating the covers and the subtitle and all that stuff. Now I got to go back and kind of just like edit them and format them a little bit. And then I have three other books in the pipeline that, you know, I had the outlines created. I just need to sit down and write between my full-time job and my three little kids that are always jumping all over me.
Wow.
But yeah, so I'm definitely actively in the market, still testing what's working, what isn't working. One last thing I wanted to give you, another tip to your readers and to you is, yeah, with the paperback books, here's what I want you to do. If you write a book, a lot of people may have even written a book on Amazon. It's not selling that well. Just do what John did. Print up a bunch of, you know, paperback copies on demand and send them. Send them in the mail with a post-it note on front, you know, on the front of it to your target customers. You know, a CEO of a company or, you know, VP of some company that you want to sell to. Hey, I wrote this book. I thought it would be, you know, I thought you would like it. I just wanted to send you a free copy. Do that twice per week. Just send out two book copies to your top leads every week. Watch what happens. Watch what happens. It's just amazing, you know? So to that point, as far as how to contact me, you can contact me through my site. It's passiveincomeplaybook.com. It's www.passiveincomeplaybook.com. I have a cheat sheet on my process. I have a training video series that I'm going to be posting up there. And I think there's even a contact section on there where you can just email me directly. So I have an online course where I walk people through this process and show them in videos and in depth the tools I use and the strategy and all that stuff. And I also do one-on-one coaching with people. But I really like selling the course because part of the course, just like with you, John, is there's a monthly call where I look at people's progress. I look at whether it's their outline or their book cover, their title or whatever, and give them that feedback. If you're interested in any of that stuff, just check out passiveincomeplaybook.com. Like I said, I'm still doing it. So I really am still testing and seeing and keeping track of what's working in the market. And of course, working with other professionals. And I like working with like other, whether they're execs, you know, or, you know, with specific expertise or consultants or coaches. But one last story, one because again, I like stories and I think it really helps people. Last year, this college kid, he was like 19 or 20 years old. He was in college in New York. He read my book, Passive Income Playbook, went through the steps, wrote a book about Instagram marketing because he knows about Instagram. He's like, man, I just read your book. I took action. I wrote an 80-page book. It's called Post Like an Influencer, Grow Like a Marketer. And it's about Instagram. He's got a beautiful cover. He's making like $500 to $800 a month from this little 80-page book that he created. When I was in college, I wasn't doing that.
Dude, that's a lot of beer money.
I was
such a knucklehead. Yeah.
He sells people Instagram marketing services on the back end. And this guy's in college.
Why is he even in college? He's an entrepreneur. He should just drop out. That's what I always tell those college entrepreneurs. I'm like, dude, you're already figured it out. You don't need to pay someone else to teach you book learning. Just go do it. But that's another topic. But that's so awesome. I love the fact that we do live, and this is a great note to end on, we live in the greatest era ever. And Amazon is just one of the tools to bottle up your expertise, to bottle up your knowledge, to demonstrate it, and to get it out on a worldwide platform for zero to very low cost, and to really make your dreams come true. And yes, that sounds like hyperbole, but it's not. Like, there's no reason anyone listening to this right now should be doing something they don't enjoy. There's no reason you cannot create a lucrative side hustle that can turn into a full-time job based around what you love, because you have the ability with social media, Amazon, all these other platforms to put out content. And your content, when you do it the right way, will convert people into clients, and you can monetize that in an incredible way. And Raza is the guy. For Amazon, I've sent a lot of people to him, people like Eric Frazier, who I hand chose and said, go talk to Raza. There's a reason he got on Morning Joe. Like, there's a reason he got that success from that book, you know? And so there's so many stories, there's so many people. Thanks, man, for coming on, because you really shared a ton of value, a ton of knowledge, and I want people to go to passiveincomeplaybook.com, find Raza Imam on Amazon, look at how he set up his books. You can learn just so much just looking through his author page. Look at his titles. They're ridiculous. I'm so jealous. They're so good. But thank you again, Raza, for coming on the show.
Man, John, thank you so much. It was really my pleasure, and I mean that sincerely. It's not like a platitude, you know. It's this is a lot of fun too. It's a lot of fun.